Hello everyone and welcome to this webinar of UPETI, where we will talk about health technology assessment and patient involvement in health technology assessment, and I hope you're all doing wonderful. We will have some interesting presentations today and also ample time for discussion, questions and answers. But first of all, I would like to start off by some introduction from our side. First of all, my name is Tamás Brecki and I will be hosting this webinar. I've been working with UPETI for several years now, and I'm also a patient advocate and a social psychologist at the same time. Our speakers today will be Com Fahey from Roche, who's the public policy manager for Roche in Ireland. And in this role, he has gained extensive knowledge of how Ireland's reimbursement systems, or system rather, compares to other European reimbursement systems. So he's an expert who has previously worked as an advisor to the Minister of Health in Ireland as well. Now, Com is also a member of the board of the Irish Platform for Patient Organizations, Science and Industry. And in this capacity, he has also been working with, together with one of our other speakers today, Joan Jordan, who is a UPETI fellow, graduated from UPETI in one of the previous cohorts. And she's also now the content coordinator for UPETI, just recently awarded this position. She's the current MS Multiple Sclerosis Ireland Person of the Year and has made a lot of life changes since she was diagnosed in 2010. She's a computer science graduate and she completed the UPETI training course in 2017. Now, what she wants to do is she wants to help make the life better for those 9,000 Irish people who live with MS by using her experience in IT, her participation in a clinical trial, and also her communication skills, and her time living abroad, and most importantly, knowing what it is like to live with an illness for which there is currently no cure, but she also wants to help find one. Another UPETI fellow will also speak today, and she's Paola Kruger. She's from Italy. Paola has a background in EU public affairs and has worked in London, Brussels, and Rome. And also, she spent 2 years working closely with EU institutions. Now, since being diagnosed with multiple sclerosis in 2010, she has turned her attention to patient advocacy, and she has been working with the MS Center of a large hospital in Rome, helping healthcare professionals to participate in EU initiatives and also developing patient-centric projects, as well as focusing on the development of a new clinician-patient approach. She's also a UPETI graduate of the second cohort, which graduated in 2017, just like Joan did, and has since been a speaker at numerous national and international events, represented patients in several boards, and has completed a course on innovation in healthcare at the INSEAD. Now, we also have another speaker from Roche, David McCarthy, and David is a market access manager with Roche in Ireland once again. So Roche and, David and Colm are colleagues and they will hold the presentation together. David leads a team of health economists, business analysts and pricing managers who develop and deliver pharmacoeconomic dossiers to the Irish health authorities. David holds an MSc in Health Economics and Pharmacoeconomics from the Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona, and he is a Bachelor of Business Studies from the Cork Institute of Technology. So these will be our speakers today. We will be monitoring your questions during the call. If you have any urgent questions for clarification, then we will stop the presentations. Otherwise, we will just go through with the presentations in one go. So without further ado, I would like to ask Paola to start with her presentation, which is already on the screen, and then we will we will carry on with the presentations and with your questions and answers. So, Paola, you take it away.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's wonderful to be here today, and I would like to share my own personal experience of HTA with you. It's rather funny because both John and myself both have MS, so we are dealing with the same disease, but today I chose not to talk about it, and because my personal experience with HTA relates to a different disease area, and I thought it would be interesting to underline for patients who don't have to work with HTA only in their own specific disease area. And I chose not to be too specific about, of course, the disease I was involved with because I didn't think it was important. What I wanted to do today is to sort of like give to you the main messages and let's say the key points that you should keep in mind when you happen to be involved in HTA. So I start with the background. The next piece, Ingrid, is what happened is that a pharma company here in Italy was launching a new drug and commissioned an HTA evaluation to an academic institution in Italy, namely a university. And but the drug company also asked for patient experts to give their evaluation of the drug and contribute their views, which I thought it was something really important. What they decided to do, which was a second element of COVID education in my opinion, was to implement the NICE model. Maybe some of you are not familiar with it, but NICE, when they make an evaluation, they often just don't want to hear from the patients who actually have the disease, but also want to hear the opinion from a patient expert, because not belonging from that disease area, patient experts sometimes can be more balanced in their views. So this is exactly what happened. So I was the odd patient, so to speak, because I was not belonging to that disease area. So next, please, Ingrid. How did it all take place? What were the different steps? Okay, so first, we as patients were given the full details of the clinical trial and were asked to provide our comments and input, which I thought was also very important because normally patients are perceived as not understanding all the language of the clinical trial, so it was a nice sort of like a sign of involvement, giving us the opportunity to review all the details of the clinical trial. And also we were asked to review a patient survey that the pharma company had prepared to argue the case in favor of the new drug. And what I thought was particularly interesting was to see which data was used and how the pharma company argued its case. For example, the survey where patients were explaining that they perceived a lack of therapeutic options, and so they asked to have more medicines. But in my opinion, the survey was sort of like done too long before. So it was like 2006, if I don't remember correctly. So I thought that, okay, but several years have gone by, and of course new therapeutic choices have come about. So it's very easy for a pharma company to say, oh, you know, patients ask us to give them more drugs. But if the data is old, then you would have that kind of answer. So I thought it was a bit forced. So it was good that we could say, yes, nice, interesting patient survey, but we think it's a little bit old. And our comments and inputs were included in the HTA evaluation as a relevant part of the dossier, which was really important. Next, please, Ingrid. So how were patients involved? So pharma decided to follow the NICE model and selected three patient representatives from a specific disease area, plus a patient expert from a different disease area, in which case it was me. The representatives of the relevant patient associations were asked to participate because of their experience of the disease. On the contrary, the additional patient expert was selected because of proven expertise, so this is where the UPATI training was very, very handy, and because of the relation of trust established over time, which is a second important point. And next slide, please, Ingrid. Why is it important to get involved? Because to get pharma relevant stakeholders to listen to patients and involve them in a consistent way, to show the patients are well trained and knowledgeable, and to establish trust with pharma and other relevant stakeholders. And because you can help decision makers understand how important a new drug can be for you and your fellow patients. So next, please, Ingrid. What are the lessons to be learned from my experience? In my opinion, the pharma companies know that you have sound knowledge and add value to their proposition, they will seek your expertise. And it doesn't matter if you don't have previous experience of HTA. If they ask you to get involved, it's because your input is valuable. Therefore, always get involved if they offer you the chance, even if you don't feel you know enough about the subject. There is plenty of information available to gain extra knowledge and free online courses to follow. I recently did one, for example. But just don't miss out on the opportunities, because it's very important for us to be involved when they ask us to. That's a way to go forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. I can see that Ingrid is already putting up the next presentation. And just while she does that, I wanted to reassure everyone that this webinar is being recorded, and the whole webinar, together with the slide decks, will be shared with you on the UPATI website. So rest assured, it's going to be there, the whole webinar. And Colm, you take it away now.
Thank you very much. I want to talk to you a bit about the reimbursement system in Ireland and how it compares with neighbouring countries in Europe. So the first point I want to make is that every country has its own system for evaluating drugs. Roche and each of these countries will enter into a negotiation with each health system to decide a price and to get access to patients. And depending on the system, it depends on how quick patients get that access. Ireland is one of a number of countries that uses HTA, but HTA is only one part of the process in our system. So this graphic tries to demonstrate all the possible permutations and combinations of drugs getting reimbursed. On the left-hand side is a process that tends not really to apply for hospital drugs, but yes, we engage in this step in order to get a refusal to move on to step two, which is the HTA process. After the HTA process, we then enter into further negotiations with the payers, and then it goes out of the National Centre for Pharma Economics and goes to the HSE Drug Group, it then goes to the HSE Leadership Team, and it can then go to the Department of Health to go for a government decision for further funding. So there's many steps in it. The HTA step is just one of those steps. And the delays in the system aren't always caused by HTA. They're often caused elsewhere further down the line.
Colm, sorry for 1 second. Can you please speak up a little? Some people complain that they can hardly hear you.
Can you hear me better now?
Oh, it's so much better. Thank you very much.
Would you like me to repeat anything?
No, I don't think that's necessary. Just go ahead.
Okay, so in terms of Roche and our experience, 10 years ago, our drugs were reimbursed roughly 3 months after EMA license. That has been pushing out each time we've put a new application in for a new drug reimbursement. The last time we received a reimbursement was 2015, and that time period was over 18 months. That was Kadcyla, and here you can see how Ireland's reimbursement system compared with all those elsewhere in Europe. On the left-hand side is the number of days since EMA approval, and Ireland is over 600 days and the second last in Western Europe. So 10 years ago, we would have been we wouldn't have been as good as Germany, but we probably would have been in the top four, but now we're at the other end of the scale. We're shortly expecting reimbursement, our first new reimbursement since 2015 for a drug called Erivage, and the timeline has worsened again. We're over 1,500 days on that, assuming we get it in early November. So you can see how far behind we are compared to all those neighbouring countries, and how patients in so many other countries have better access to new drugs than Irish patients now have. So it's not just related to rush drugs. This is data we bought from IMS showing the number of sales of new oncology drugs that were approved by the EMA between 2014 and 2016. So these aren't reimbursed sales. They can be out-of-pocket sales as well. But again, it's showing the same picture, Ireland having the worst access to new medicines. And outside of oncology, this is data from EFPIA, which is the European-wide industry association, showing the rate of availability of new drugs in each of the countries in Europe. And Ireland is, again, last in Western Europe, last in the EU15, just ahead of Bulgaria. So Erivedge is a drug that we're expecting reimbursement in shortly. This is the webpage from the National Center for Pharmaeconomics. You can see that we began our application for reimbursement in May 2013, and we're expecting to receive it in November 2017. To show how the system isn't very systematic, here's an example of a different drug, or can be, for cystic fibrosis. It's not a rush drug. They applied for reimbursement in November 2015, and they received it around March time this year. So that drug, the media were reporting, was the most expensive drug ever to be purchased by the Irish state, yet its reimbursement timeline is far, far lower than our drug, Erivedge. This is an article about drugs that are effectively stuck in the system. All these drugs, a price has been agreed between the pharmaceutical company and the state. They've been through the HTA process, and they've been stuck somewhere else because no funding has been allocated for them. The journalist did a bit of research to see which countries they're available in and which countries they aren't. And if you see at the very bottom of the screen, Ireland is the only country that has red dots for them all, where they're not available. Ireland's the only country where none of them are available in. So those drugs are on the way to reimbursement now, but they're on the way to reimbursement not really because of any systematic approach, but because of investigative journalism from the state broadcaster and from a journalist with the Sunday Business Post in particular. So the hold-up for these drugs wasn't necessarily HTA. All of those drugs were through the HTA process and got held up at a later point. So again, that is Erivedge, the drug we're expecting to be reimbursed next, our first drug since 2015. And I think it clearly illustrates the environment that we're facing in Ireland now with large delays. We agreed a price with the payer about a year ago, and it's been held up due to lack of funding, and would have been through the HTA process a good bit before we agreed the price as well. So I think that gives a good indication of the current environment in Ireland. And myself and Dave will be happy to take any questions.
I can't see anyone. There are some people who have raised their hands. Do you want to ask a question at this point, or you've raised your hands because you had an issue? I will. Yes. Who is this? I can hear you. Who is this?
So, yeah, we're here. We're glad to take any questions if there are any.
Okay, apparently not. So why don't we just move on to John's presentation, and I'm sure that there will be additional questions as soon as we finish with the presentations. Well, I surely will have questions to you. So Joan, are you ready? I understand that Ingrid will show your slides, and then you can start with your talk, as I can see. Go ahead.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Loud and clear?
Absolutely.
Good. Good evening, everyone, and today I'm going to talk to you a bit about a specific situation with HTA, and like Paula said, it's really important to be involved in HTA when you do get the opportunity to be involved. So if you get asked, then then take the opportunity. I didn't know much myself about HTA until a few years ago, but now, Ingrid, if you could move on to the next slide, I just want to tell you a bit about my own illness. I have multiple sclerosis. So there's a few different types of multiple sclerosis, but at diagnosis stage, you either get diagnosed with relapsing, remitting, or primary progressive. So in relapsing, remitting multiple sclerosis, people have distinct attacks or symptoms which fade away either partially or completely. And about 85% of people with multiple sclerosis are diagnosed with this type. So to me, I have this type. There's 14 different disease-modifying therapies, or DMTs, currently available to treat my form of multiple sclerosis. My drug is paid for by the Irish government, and I'm internally grateful to that because it's quite expensive, so there's no way I'd be able to afford to pay for the medication myself. For most people with multiple sclerosis, this is the way their MS begins, except for the small group of people who have primary progressive MS. This is about 15%, and as it currently stands, there are no disease-modifying therapies for people with primary progressive. Next slide, please, Ingrid. So I've taken this from the MS Society UK. This is really, really exciting news for people with MS because a new drug has been developed which can slow the progression of MS according to the results of its phase 3 trials. It's the first treatment that can slow the advancement of primary progressive MS. This is a really big deal. It can also treat relapsing remitting MS. The drug is an intravenous infusion treatment that has been developed by Roche. In March 2017, it was approved by the US FDA, so it's already been approved in the States as a treatment for both relapsing and primary progressive MS. So this is really important. So it's already been approved in the States. It is being reviewed by the EMA currently, and a decision is expected in autumn 2017. So the current phase of the trial is under review by the EMA, and it is suitable for primary progressive and relapsing remitting MS. Next slide, please, Ingrid. So when is this drug likely to become available? Because what happens with MS is we hear about these drugs all the time that are, you know, coming down the line, people get very excited, and then it just seems like we wait an eternity for the drug to actually be available to us. So in July 2016, Roche submitted a licensing application to the EMA, the body responsible for licensing drugs in Europe. The EMA has accepted this application and is currently reviewing the data. We expect a decision to be announced in late 2017. In March 2017, the drug was approved by the US FDA as a treatment for both relapsing and primary progressive MS. Next slide, please, Ingrid. So now, this is the problem. Using the projected HTA calculations, it is quite possible that the drug will be approved as cost-effective for relapsing remitting MS in Ireland, but not for primary progressive. This is because for primary progressive, the comparison is made to the best supportive care, and in this case, the best supportive care is nothing. So it's just a real shame for people with primary progressive who are so keen to get access to this drug. Next slide, please, Ingrid. So, because we already know that it's likely that this situation is going to occur, what can Ireland do about this? We need to engage with all the players here. As Colm spoke about the NCPE, the National Centre for Pharmacoeconomics, as a patient group submission template. So we can use this template to really state our case. Next slide, please, Ingrid. So we've got other strategies apart from the patient template. Unfortunately, MS Ireland does not have a patient registry, so surveys are being used to gather data rather than relying on anecdotal evidence. Now, Paola spoke about surveys that were out of date, so we need to make sure that we have surveys that are recent, that are current, that a lot of people in Ireland with MS complete the surveys so that we have strong data. Also, we can work with patient organisations. We can work with IPOSI in Ireland. We can work with Roche, with the pharmaceutical company, and then the NCPE. That's the form I just showed you in the previous slide, to become familiar with the current process. So, right at the start, when you start looking at HTA, there's a lot of acronyms. It's very difficult to understand, you know, the whole process. But the UPATI course really helped me to know my ICERs from my qualies. From a countrywide perspective, we need to call for the development of a new sustainable national strategy on access to new and innovative drug therapies in Ireland, involving all key stakeholders, including patient groups and the public. We can also collaborate with other MS societies from other countries to gather data. I know, like Colm said, every country is different, their processes are different, but there's a lot that we can share, I think. I spoke about this already, about applying my UPATI experience of HTA theory to navigate the process in an Irish context. Now, like I said, a few years ago, I didn't even know what HTA was. I just knew that it took such a long time for a drug to actually become available. But it explains somewhat why it takes so long, but then we as patients need to work together to do anything we can do to expedite the drug becoming available. Then Paula mentioned this, to refresh my HTA knowledge, there's a fantastic free course from the University of Glasgow on HTA, and it's a really excellent course. There's a lot of video content in it, so I would recommend that course for anybody who wanted to just look into what exactly HTA is and how it can be applied. And then I'm also saving up to buy Karen Facey's book. We got the opportunity to see Karen in person on the UPATI training course. So her book on patient involvement and health technology assessment is really, it would be really useful, I think, if you get very, very involved into HTA. Next slide, please, Ingrid. So that kind of is it in a nutshell. Wish becomes do. We really wish that this drug is going to become available to people with primary progressive MS as soon as possible, and how can we help do that as patients. So that's the end of the presentation. Thank you. And I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Joan, very much. And I can already see that there are some questions trickling in and some people have raised their hands. But I will start with the questions that I already have on my screen now. And one goes, I think, to both Colm and maybe also to some extent Joan. And this is, why do you think that this process is so slow in Ireland? So why does this take so long, in your view, to get through the HTA and reimbursement process? What do you think?
Would you like me to go first?
You go first, Colm.
It's because there's so many stages to the system. So we will submit a rapid review, probably from CHMP positive opinion. We know the rapid review is going to send it to HTA, yet we still need to do that step of the system. The HTA is one of the parts of the system where we have some bit of a grip and understanding of what the timelines and the processes will be. But then we're into negotiations with the HSE, which can take longer. And at that stage, it goes to the HSE drugs group. So, you know, there's a bit of duplication there because we've already gone through quite a lengthy process and systematic process with the payer. It's then going on to the health services, another committee in the health service. And when they agree to a price, it then goes on to yet another committee in the health service, the HSE leadership team. You know, these groups only meet a certain number of times of the year. So each time it has to move up a step, you have to wait for a scheduled meeting and hope that it gets to the top of the agenda in that meeting. When we get to the top of the HSE, when the HSE leadership team approve it, to date, or in the last year or so, they've all then been going to the Department of Health. And the Department of Health has been doing what they're calling a due diligence check to ensure that the payer can't fund it out of their own resources before deciding whether or not to progress it to Cabinet to get extra funding. So all these extra steps just add to bureaucracy, and there seems to be quite a lot of duplication in the system. The graphs showing Ireland's timeline compared to the rest of the EU15 shows that other countries can make decisions on these exact same drugs and do negotiations much quicker than Ireland. So the question we'd pose is, why is Ireland the slowest?
Yeah, I think something interesting that Paula said, Colm, is that what the process that they followed mirrored NICE.
There was also a question about NICE. Someone asked this in writing. You can actually look it up pretty easily in on the UPATI website, but also on the website of NICE itself, which is the HTA body of the UK, or of England rather, and their model is followed in several countries very, very regularly. But there's also a couple of other questions that I would like to raise here that people have asked and that have been flagged by our colleague Matthew May, who's also monitoring your questions. So, Joan, you said that there's extra training about HTA from Glasgow that you took. Do you think that the session in the UPATI training misses something, or was that not enough? And this question also goes to Paula then. Is that enough, or is it not satisfactory and you need something more?
I think the HTA process itself is so complicated, it's probably never enough to know everything about it, and that's why I mentioned Karen Facey's book as well. I mean, that's a huge book, and there's so much information in there. Now, the UPATI course gave a very comprehensive account of HTA from a European perspective. The one from the University of Glasgow, the difference with that was that it kind of gave examples. So it gave case studies. There was actually, I can't remember the name of it, but they did something with footballers in different, well, not actually footballers, football fans, and that they were offered the opportunity to either train at their favourite football ground, and then the control group wouldn't have trained, and they kind of made a comparison on it, and it was just, the videos were really, really interesting, I thought. So the two just were good for various different reasons. The course, the University of Glasgow course, is free, so you can do it at your own pace. It took me you can do it over 2 weeks. I think it took me maybe 4 or 5 hours to complete it. And I just think, why not take all the opportunities that are offered to you to learn as much as possible about HTA?
Yeah, I actually quite agree with you. Yes, it's such a complex issue. It's difficult to know everything about it. And also, let not forget that as patient representatives, we are multitasking, so we work in many different situations representing patients at all different levels. So we don't do HTA every day like somebody maybe working in an HTA agency. So it's good to refresh your knowledge, and sometimes it's needed. And also another important issue is that the HTA systems are all different throughout Europe. So maybe sometimes it's good to know a little bit more about other systems, because it helps you to give you a general perspective. And they differ quite a lot. So I think
absolutely,
it's important,
Paula,
sometimes, to have an inside view also of different systems. It helps us to have a more comprehensive view. But I have to say the UPATI module on HTA has been excellent. We had the opportunity to meet both Karen Faces and Victoria Thomas from NICE. And to me personally, they've been really, really enlightening. And I often carry on the examples that I learned from them. So I thought UPATI course was excellent as a base, but then we need to build on from that.
Sure. I think, I mean, as one of the UPATI trainers and content contributors, I also think we never really wanted to do anything really comprehensive about any of the topics, but we just wanted to give you the opportunity to find your way through this maze of these topics. And HTA is of course just one of the many topics that the UPATI training course discusses. Now there's another question to all speakers, which concerns funding. And the question is, there has to be new funding to be found for each new drug. Is that true? Because person who asked comes from Norway, says that hospitals would have to find funding within their existing budgets for any approved drugs. What is your take on this, on the funding issue?
I personally know that in Italy it doesn't happen that way. It would be nice, but sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes there are problems with finding the drugs that have been approved.
Mm-hmm.
So the theory is different from the practice sometimes. But that's the way it is.
Okay. Others?
Our experience in Ireland there has not been an increase in the drugs budget, which brought the reimbursement of new drugs to a halt until that was discovered by the media. And now funding has been found for 9 drugs that were held up in the system. We'll have to wait until the budget in October or the HSE service plan after that to see whether additional funding will be made available for new drugs next year.
Yeah, it's actually quite interesting in Ireland what a big part the media plays. I don't know if it's the same in other countries, but you know, if something gets on the news, then generally the money eventually gets found.
Oh, that's interesting. So that there is sort of an influence by the public opinion and by media.
Absolutely.
That's a really interesting lesson to learn. Because that also offers a possibility for patient advocates and activists to make sort of an impact. Someone asks here about whether these processes are for the EU, for EU members only, or also for developing countries. I think that it's very important to note here what was pointed out by Matthew as well. In a message a couple of minutes ago, that actually in UPATI we deal with EU level processes and policies only, while HTA is done on a national level. So all countries have or should have their own HTA bodies, and they are responsible for the given countries. So that's why there are so many differences in this process, because these countries tend to use different methodologies, and NICE is just one of the examples that was mentioned here. Now, there was another question about whether there's increased bureaucracy or more bureaucracy in Ireland. I think that was answered to some extent by saying that Colm said that indeed it's a bit more bureaucratic than in other countries, if I understand you well.
Yes, it does seem to be more bureaucratic, in that ideally when the HTA is done and a price is agreed with the corporate pharmaceutical unit, it would be ideal if we could conclude at that stage when a price is agreed and reimburse the drug. But unfortunately, there's more stages to the process, and the latest agreement with industry added another stage to that. Now there's news reports saying that stage has since been removed. But the trend is to add more and more stages, which creates more and more delays.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see. Now, someone suggests that there are certain opinions and calls to make the whole process of pricing for the EU in general, so that there would be a blanket policy. I think that this is also a suggestion or a hint towards the joint procurement procedure in order to avoid repetition and delay in getting the drugs to every single country. What is your opinion on this, asks one of the participants.
I think it would be great to have one system. I think this is one of the tasks of UNETA, as we know it, to try and find some common grounds among all the different systems and try to find some sort of like kind of areas where we can all have the same level in Europe. But it's not that easy, as we know. It's the history of the EU, isn't it? Whenever you touch national interests, it's very difficult to have a model that fits every country.
Yeah, this is Joan. I think it's certainly fairer. Because, I mean, you know, if another country gets, somebody living in a different country gets access to a particular drug,
yeah,
it's not fair.
Now, my question then, or I would like to direct this question to Colin and David from Roche. Would it be beneficial from an industry perspective to have a unified procedure in Europe or for the whole of the European Union, or do you think that would be counterproductive?
I think it's David here. I think in principle, a unified perspective is good because there is a lot of duplication in the way the HTA processes work across Europe. However, the breakdown of health systems would determine that there are localized costs that are experienced throughout the system, whether you know care is delivered in a primary care environment versus a hospital environment, which do drive cost, and it obviously would then influence the cost effectiveness of a treatment. So in principle, there are parts to it, especially the clinical assessment that certainly could be conducted on an EU-wide level, but the localized costings would still need to be factored in at a national level.
Mm. Makes sense. Now, my question, and this is my question, not something I quote from the participants. It really goes to the two patient advocates, Joan and Paola. Why do you think it is beneficial for patients to bother? I mean, why would you want to learn all of this very complicated theoretical and sometimes quite arcane processes? Do you see any direct benefit for yourselves for your communities or for your therapeutic area?
Absolutely.
Sorry, go ahead, Paola.
Yeah, I think sometimes, I mean, I don't want the decision about access to medicine to be left to institutions and pharma companies or whatever. I think the voice of the patient is fundamental. Let's not forget that it's a patient who has the experience of the disease. So as much as you can discuss about a certain disease, you cannot understand it if you don't live with it. So the role of the patient is fundamental in this sense. You know, learning all these difficult methodologies, everything helps to convey your message, and it has to be done in a certain way. You cannot just say, oh no, it's important for me to have the medicine. No, you have to play following the rules, and the rules are there is an HTA process. So if you learn the rules, then you are allowed also to express your opinion, and sometimes your opinion makes a difference. And there, I know loads of cases where the voice of patients has made people who had to make the decision realize they were going the wrong way.
Okay, I agree completely with Paola, and I mean, I don't want to stand at the sidelines and wait for the HTA process to go through. I want to do something, I want to get involved, I want to help, and the example that I gave about the first drug being potentially made available for people with primary progressive MS, I mean, this is my illness, this is my disease, it's personal. I've got skin in the game here, and standing by and just waiting. We hear about these drugs, it's already been approved by the FDA, and you know, just it's so frustrating that it's taking so long, and anything that we as patients, as patient organizations, because we are stronger together, we can learn from each other, we can you know, get together, work together to understand the process first of all, because you can't make something better until you understand it, and then once we do understand it, then do what we can to help to make things better, more efficient.
All right, makes sense. There's also a very interesting issue raised here by by one of the participants who's also a former UPATI participant or fellow herself. And she says that, or she points out that actually there are two different HTA processes, one going on the EMA on the European level, while the other one on a national or regional level. And that these two are actually combined, so to say, while in the second process, the local health system is also taken into account. But this second HTA process considers or is based on information from the EMA health technology assessment procedure. So the question is, to what extent do you think it makes it more complicated? This also, for me, hints towards a more unified system, or maybe something that we would like to achieve more on a European level or on an EU level. And then another interesting comment is that UNETA will not solve this problem in the different countries. It only improves the quality of health technology assessment in different countries. What's your take on that? What do you think about this?
Well, this is Joan. It seems to me that the way that things are at the moment is that individual countries are working in silos, and it would make sense that we collaborate.
Yeah, I agree. It would really help patients.
Sorry, but Paula, I couldn't hear you. But couldn't hear what you said.
Said it would really help patients to have a unified system, but unfortunately, I don't see it coming.
Oh, okay.
Systems are too fragmented. There are so many different issues at stake, but it would be very beneficial for patients, also to be able to share experiences and to be able to sort of group together.
I also understand that health technology assessment is not only for medicine, but it is for all sorts of health interventions, health technologies, if you like. Do you remember any examples from your practice or from other patient advocates' experience that concerned other health technologies than medicine, like surgical interventions or medical devices? Any experience with that?
Not personally. I've heard about medical devices, so I know about something about HTA in medical devices, but I haven't had any personal experience. But as I say, patients are not so fully involved yet, so we're still at the beginning of the process. So it's still like very much different spots, no? Sometimes you are involved, sometimes you are not. But I think it's important to be involved, because the more we show that we are there and we are prepared and we want to get involved, the more they will involve us.
Tomash, the University of Glasgow video does give some very good examples of devices.
Oh, okay. So not just for medicine, but also for devices.
Yeah.
Good. I actually, my take on this is that I can see patient advocates learning about health technology assessment as part of a broader process of patient education. Do you think that that patient education can improve? This, of course, this is a bit of a leading question because I'm a patient expert myself, but do you think that patient education can practically improve the medicine quality, so the quality of health technologies, medicines, and other interventions available?
Absolutely, and I think the earlier that patients are involved, the better output you get.
Patients are part of the check and balances system, so they're needed as well. And of course, also to make the whole system better, and also the development of medicines to improve it.
But my question goes now to Colm and David. What do you think about, how do you see the role of patient education in your work, or in the development, research and development work of a large pharmaceutical company like where you work?
I think that patient education around treatments, especially around clinical trial development, is crucial because the patient understands firsthand what it's like to experience any treatment that they take. I think that probably comes in at a much earlier phase than the HTA process, and it's really more around clinical trial setup and development rather than where simply engaging at the HTA space. But it's a welcome addition to have the patient voice heard at the cost effectiveness assessment also. So I think it will be widely accepted that the patient is a critical part of the decision-making process, and it's welcome that it's becoming more apparent and more available.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that there's an interesting comment from one of the participants saying that the speakers from industry clearly said that a unified system would be not a good option because of the cost calculations, which need to remain national. Would you agree? Was that the right understanding of what you said?
Yeah, I think that within reason. I mean, there's certain treatments that would are more complex in their delivery and the mechanism in each country, which would obviously drive costs and ultimately drive the cost effectiveness thresholds for that country, and also recognizing that each country has a different willingness to pay. So you know, it's always an issue of scarcity of resources and ensuring that there's an equitable and fair system for everyone in that country. So I think that, from a country by country perspective, that localized costs have to be taken into consideration. But there are certainly areas that there are synergies, and I think that it's welcome to explore them also.
Mm-hmm. Now another question is, and this goes to Paola and Joan. After graduating from the UPATI course, where you learned about the basics and like the whole framework of health technology assessment, where did you go to learn more about your own local systems? Where how could you obtain that information that was necessary for your local involvement?
Go ahead, Joe.
Thanks, Paola. Like I said, just about standing on the sidelines, I just, having been given the gift of getting a place on the UPATI course, getting the training, I just felt like I had to take the ball and run with it then. So getting involved with organisations, I just, our local IPOSI, this is the Irish Patient Organisation, I started attending meetings, I started to network, I started to speak to people. I blog a lot, so I wrote blogs about things. I contacted the relevant organisations and just basically got out there, and nobody was going to come to my front door and say, I hear that you did the UPATI course. So I just got out there, and I'm not naturally a very outgoing person, but I felt it was important to just start to network, get out there. If there's something going on, then to attend it. And then once I did attend, to network and to just get into conversations and try and get involved in things.
I agree. It's actually not a matter of going out and reading all the theory or what is happening in your country and what are the guidelines, but it's a matter of like getting involved in the process. And it is an ongoing process. You maybe don't start from HTA, you start from different areas, but you start participating and speaking to people, and especially building a relationship of trust with pharma companies. And then at that point, they understand that you know about the issue and they want you to get involved, and you get the opportunity and you go on, and you get the opportunity and you learn by doing, and you know, you become part of the system and you learn little bit, but in practice you don't actually read a lot. You can sort of like get the theory as well, but it's more about practice.
Absolutely. Mm.
Yes, I think it's quite important also because it's so new in many countries. Like, I come from Central Europe, and HTA bodies are just being set up here mostly. So this means that oftentimes you will not even be able to find more detailed information. So indeed, it's more like getting involved and doing it like hands on. Someone from the participants asked about better, more practical examples in terms of patient involvement and the benefits of patient involvement in HTA decision making. And let me answer this one. If you go to the UPATI website, www.upati.eu, then you will find plenty of examples in the UPATI toolbox on medicine development, which contains case studies and also fact sheets about various forms of patient involvement throughout the research and development process of medicines, and also in clinical trials from the earliest stages up to when a drug or a medicine is already on the market. And these examples also include examples, practical examples for HTA involvement of patients. So I think that that's probably the best repository for this kind of knowledge.
Definitely.
thank you. And with this, because I don't see any additional questions pertaining to this topic that we had today, namely health technology assessment, I just want to call your attention once again that the entire webinar has been recorded and will be shared with you on the UPATI website. Once again, www.upati.eu, together with the slides that were shown by the presenters. You will have to wait about 48 hours for this to become available. I hope to see you again soon for our next webinar. The invitation will be sent out by Ingrid, as always. Thank you very much to all of you, all the presenters, Joan, Paola, Colm, and David.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for Ingrid and Matthew for the background work answering the questions. And thank you to all the participants for joining us for this webinar. Take care. Stay safe. Bye-bye.